Hello and welcome to this edition of FYI Weekly, your official source for City of Greensboro news and information. The City of Greensboro Office of Sustainability and Resilience has published its 2023 Annual Progress Report and Strategic Energy Plan Implementation Year 1. This inaugural report provides a high-level overview of the programs, initiatives, and policy changes the office championed and charts the progress the city has made toward meeting the goals of its 2022 Strategic Energy Plan. The Office of Sustainability and Resilience was established 2 years ago, tasked with supporting a variety of sustainability efforts, including how the city will reduce its greenhouse gas footprint and transition to 100% renewable energy by 2040. The office, in partnership with other city departments, is accelerating its efforts to address the gaps within our local government operations. The goal is for these actions to further transform mindsets of city officials, residents, and local businesses. Last year, the Office of Sustainability and Resilience launched new programs to reduce food waste, encourage sustainable landscaping, and recognize residents, businesses, and nonprofits that practice sustainability. Departments work toward reducing electrical demands on city buildings, converting fleet vehicles to all electric, and securing grant funding for a tree canopy audit. To read about these projects and other highlights in the report, visit the city's website. Guilford works in partnership with the North Carolina Department of Commerce Division of Workforce Solutions will host the first of a series of workshops on Monday, April 1st. The Fierce Fellows program is designed for justice-involved individuals who are seeking employment opportunities to assist them with re-entry to society. The series of weekly workshops will include career counseling, promoting engagement, and other support services. These sessions will be hosted every Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. for consecutive weeks. Participants who complete the program will receive a $500 stipend during the ceremony on Wednesday, May 1st, when they will also receive a certificate of completion. The workshops take place at the NC Works Career Center located at 2301 West Meadowview Road. For more information about the Fierce Fellows program, visit the city's website. The City of Greensboro is conducting a survey to assess the needs of the Downtown Business Improvement District. This is being done in advance of advertising an official request for proposal. The survey is available online to all interested stakeholders through Friday, March 29th. The input will help inform the scope of work that an entity will be contracted to manage on behalf of the city, beginning with the new budget year in July. Property owners in this district pay a tax rate of 9 cents per $100 of value on their property. The tax goes into a special fund. The revenue covers a range of programs and services, facilities, and developmental activities above and beyond what the city would typically provide through the budget. Again, the Downtown Business Improvement District survey is available online to all interested stakeholders through Friday, March 29th. Cone Health has partnered with the city to share a series of brief and informative videos designed to inspire you to make better choices when it comes to healthy living. Following these tips is an easy way to help each of us improve our quality of life. Let's take a moment to check out today's news for your health.
How strong is your heart health knowledge? Let's test your heart smarts with a few facts or fiction statements. The answers will lead to a healthy heart. Let's get started. Exercise needs to be difficult. Fiction. Exercise should be enjoyable. The American Heart Association does recommend 150 minutes of moderate exercise every week. That would be 30 minutes, five times a week, of exercise that might make you a little bit flushed or a little bit winded. In fact, exercise doesn't have to be what we traditionally think of as exercise. Cleaning the house, gardening are all forms of an active lifestyle and beneficial exercise. Chest discomfort or pain do not always occur with a heart attack. Fact: While many patients will present with chest discomfort or arm pain as their symptom of a heart attack, not everybody does. The symptoms can vary. Some people will present with more atypical symptoms, such as jaw discomfort, nausea, or shortness of breath. If you feel like you might be having a heart attack, please always call 911. If you don't have a family history of heart disease, you don't need to worry about your cholesterol level. Fiction. The American Heart Association suggests that starting at age 20, everybody should have their cholesterol level checked every 5 years. While cholesterol is not the only risk factor for heart disease, it is an important risk factor, and modifications with diet or exercise and sometimes medications are necessary depending on your cholesterol level. Everybody needs to take an aspirin once a day. Fiction. Aspirin is an important medication, and it can help prevent heart disease in some individuals. Aspirin needs to be prescribed by your provider. Talk to your provider, and they can assess your risk of heart disease and whether or not you would benefit from a daily aspirin. Salads are not always healthy. Fact. While salads can be an important part of a heart-healthy diet, they can also be loaded with excess calories. Fruits and vegetables and healthy oils are recommended to reduce the risk of heart and vascular disease. However, we need to be mindful of our choices and our portion sizes. I don't add salt to my food, so I'm taking care of my heart. Fiction. While it can be very important not to add salt at the table, we also have to be aware that many of the foods that we get that are processed or from a restaurant often are very high in sodium. We need to be aware of how much salt we're getting in our food, not just what we're adding at the table. I don't smoke, so I'm not going to get heart disease. Fiction. Smoking is one of the most important modifiable risk factors for heart disease. But there are other risk factors as well, including diabetes, high cholesterol, and weight. It's important that none of us smokes cigarettes, but we also have to be aware of these other risk factors. Thanks for joining me. Heart disease is the number one cause of death in the United States. But there are steps you can take today to reduce your risk for heart disease. To learn more about taking care of your heart, go to conehealth.com/heart. I'm Dr. Jake Hochran.
Greensboro celebrates the first year of a popular pilot program, and the city is on the receiving end of some sought-after federal funding. We'll have those stories and more news coming up after the break. Stay with us. Welcome back to FYI Weekly. The city of Greensboro is celebrating the one-year anniversary of its food waste collection pilot program by adding a new drop-off location. The Congregational United Church of Christ on West Radiance Drive is accepting food waste. This program allows members of the congregation and the neighborhood to turn food waste into valuable compost and reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The successful community partnership program, which began last April, collects eggshells, meat, fish, vegetables, certified compostable serveware, and unbleached coffee filters and paper towels. The waste is composted by Triad Compost Service. Ever since the program relocated its drop-off location at Deep Roots Market on North Eugene Street last October, residents have been dropping off more than 2,000 pounds of food waste each month. According to the United States Department of Agriculture, about a third of food intended for human consumption in the U.S. is discarded, meaning all the resources used to process, transport, prepare, and store the food were also wasted. Food production generates carbon dioxide emissions, and food sent to landfills generates methane, making food waste a significant cause of greenhouse gas emissions and, in turn, climate change. To participate in the food waste collection program, look for the green labeled carts at each drop-off location. For more information, visit the city's website. The city of Greensboro will be receiving federal funding in the impressive amount of $6.9 million for parks and recreation projects and the J. Douglas Galyon Depot. The U.S. House and Senate Transportation, Housing, and Urban Development Appropriations subcommittees voted on the continuing resolutions earlier this month. This allocation, earmarked for Greensboro, will assist with the advancement of the following community projects: $4 million for the Atlantic and Yadkin Greenway, more than $1 million for the contaminated property at Bingham Park, another $1 million for the Windsor-Chavis-Noco Community Complex, and $850,000 for the J. Douglas Galyon Depot. Greensboro Mayor Nancy Vaughn said, "We thank Congresswoman Kathy Manning for playing a key role in our community receiving this much-needed funding. The nearly $7 million will contribute to significant quality of life projects such as remediating contamination and restoring Bingham Park, improving the historic J. Douglas Galyon Depot, and construction of the Windsor-Chavis-Noco Community Complex located in East Greensboro." The continuing resolution for these bills was sent to President Biden for his signature. The city of Greensboro is being granted $825,000 from the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Forest Service to conduct a five-year tree canopy study. The grant will be managed by the city's Office of Sustainability and Resilience with support from other city departments. The competitive grant is one of 385 awarded by the Forest Service to plant and maintain trees, combat extreme heat and climate change, and improve access to nature. The city's project is titled Keeping the Green in Greensboro, a Tree Canopy Assessment and Equity Prioritization. This will include an assessment of how much of the city is covered by trees. This research has not been conducted in Guilford County since 2009. Greensboro Chief Sustainability Officer Dr. Sri Dorestant said, in addition to the tree canopy study, the grant will fund creating an equity prioritization tool to restore and/or expand tree canopies in our disadvantaged communities. The project will also include a website for community engagement, data tracking, maps, and resources for visualizing and providing feedback about the study. For more information about the grant program, visit the website for the U.S. Forest Service. The City of Greensboro supports the growth and development of small business ventures, especially for minorities and women. Coming up after the break, we'll showcase the resources available through Piedmont Business Capital. Stay with us. Welcome back to FYI Weekly. Small business owners who are in need of support services and financial assistance have a local lender to turn to who understands their unique situations and needs. Joining me now to tell us about the variety of services on tap is Michael McKinney. He is the Executive Director of Piedmont Business Capital. Hello, Michael. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for joining me. For those who are not familiar, tell us about the mission for Piedmont Business Capital.
Well, you know, Piedmont Business Capital has been around for 32 years, and our mission is really about creating economic prosperity through equitable lending and investment, particularly in low to moderate income businesses and those that are impacted by the economic impact zone. So,
okay, well, it's good to know that you are specifically available to attend to that sector of our business community. What types of businesses fall under that category that you're servicing?
So, the lending products that we offer to small businesses are for small business expansion, mm-hmm. office expansion, office equipment, some very small franchises, as well as we offer financing for businesses that want to do business with the city or the county for that matter. We offer bond financing premiums. Many of the small underserved community businesses are not able to pay their bond premiums up front that want to do business with the city. And so we offer products for that too. And so the whole idea is to provide a source of capital to small businesses who have been long denied access to capital.
Okay, well, it's good to know that they have somewhere to turn. Now, in addition to financial support, what other services do these businesses benefit from?
The target audience of businesses that we really go after, many of them don't understand the technical expertise that mm-hmm. go along with running a business, from providing a very strategic and strong and well-strengthened business plan mm-hmm. To understanding financial statements and all of those things. And so we offer that technical assistance to many of those businesses in helping them to put together a nice business plan, understand their financials, mm-hmm. being able to read those and understand the guidance of the businesses as they move forward to growth, sustainability, and expansion.
And that is invaluable because that really sets the foundation for future growth and just the overall scope of the services. But approximately how much funding do you estimate that you award each year? And is this money a grant?
Well, we have many different pockets of funds available. Over the course of our history, we have lent more than tens of millions of dollars out to small businesses and helping small businesses. It's very rarely we have any grants that we offer. Occasionally, we may have a private funder that want to provide a specific pot of money for a certain segment of businesses, but that's not generally the case. Usually, they're all loans. We have flexibility. We understand that the clientele that we target, the market that we target, it may not be the type of market that would go to a traditional bank to obtain financing for their business. And so it allows us to have flexibility and to work with them to strengthen their ideas and their businesses so that they can grow and hire other people and build wealth in that own way. So
fantastic. And this helps our minority and women-owned businesses.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So if someone is listening and they feel like this is who you're speaking to and they want to get either the resources or the financial support, how do they get started?
I'd say visit our website at PiedmontBusinessCapital.org. You can go right there, find out all of the information you need to know, the different financial products we have available. You can even apply for a loan right there on our website. And so it comes right into our office, and we have our loan officers that will reach out to you the same day and begin a conversation and see where you are and what has to be done once they've analyzed your situation.
Okay, well, thank you, Michael, for explaining that and all that you and your team do to assist our small business community. Do feel free to come back anytime and give us updates and just progress reports on how this is going, but we always want to keep people connected to the real services that impact real people.
Well, thank you so much for the opportunity, and we're so excited to be able to serve the low to moderate income businesses, our minority and our women businesses, particularly in Eastern Greensboro and the low economic impact zones in 1 and 2.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay tuned for some interesting and useful information about Greensboro as we tell you something about the city. That's coming up after the break. Stay with us. Welcome back to FYI Weekly. One way to stay informed about decisions that impact you and our city is by attending or tuning in to City Council meetings at 5:30 p.m. on the first and third Tuesday of the month. The fourth Tuesday is reserved for a meeting as needed. These City Council meetings take place in the Katie Dorsett Council Chamber on Level 2 of the Melvin Municipal Office Building, located at 300 West Washington Street. The public is allowed in person, but only in a limited capacity. Those who choose not to be in the building can participate virtually. The Greensboro City Council meetings are broadcast right here on GTN. The meetings are also streamed live on the city's website and on Roku. To review the council meeting schedule and agendas, please visit the city's website. Here's an opportunity to learn a little something about the city. With support from local residents and conservation groups, the Greensboro City Council adopted a policy to promote the use of native plants and eliminate invasive plants at city-owned facilities. Native plants help maintain, restore, and protect the health and biodiversity of local ecosystems, supporting native pollinators, birds, and other wildlife. Native plants also require less maintenance in addition to being part of the historical and cultural heritage of the community. In contrast, invasive plants disrupt the native ecosystem and displace native plants and animals. The policy is applied when the city installs new or replacement plants in landscaped areas of city-owned or maintained facilities. The city must use at least 50% seeds and plants classified as native to North Carolina or the southeastern United States by next year. It's important to note the policy does not apply to private property. For more information about native and invasive plants, visit the website for the North Carolina Native Plant Society. Coming up after the break, we'll showcase our department spotlight. But first, prepare to mark your calendars for all the places to go and things to do on the town.
I'm Dave, and here are some special events happening this week on the town. The Green Hill Center for North Carolina Art presents its headline exhibit of the year now through June 29th. Titled Leap, Artists Imagine Outer Space, the display features works of fiber art, animation, photography, painting, and other media that inspire audiences to consider our place in the universe. For gallery hours and more information, visit greenhillnc.org. Tina, the Tina Turner musical, comes to the Tanger Center for 8 shows March 26th through the 31st. A talented cast tells the uplifting story of a woman who broke barriers and became the queen of rock and roll. As you might expect, it's set to the soundtrack of Turner's most beloved hits. Find tickets and more information online at tangercenter.com. Don't wait to get your tickets to the Greensboro Science Center's laser light show set to the music of Pink Floyd on March 29th. 3 evening shows will feature a mix of tracks from the English rock band's Dark Side of the Moon album, one of the most critically acclaimed records in history. For tickets and more information, visit greensboroscience.org. Comedy fans don't want to miss We Them One's comedy tour March 30th at the Greensboro Coliseum. Mike Epps hosts a notable group of headline performers, including the likes of D-Ray Davis, DC Young Fly, and Carlos Miller. See the full list of acts and find tickets online at greensborocoliseum.com. Stay tuned to FYI Weekly for more happenings on the town.
Welcome back. The city of Greensboro has more than 20 departments and several divisions committed to serving you, our residents, and visitors. Let's go behind the scenes in our department spotlight. The Water Resources Department invites students to join the Piedmont's first ever Model Water Tower competition, co-hosted by NC1 Water. The competition aims to educate and engage youth about water resource engineering, infrastructure, water treatment, and water conservation in hopes of sparking interest in future related professions. Individuals or teams of up to 4 elementary and middle school students must register in advance. Middle school and elementary school participants cannot combine on one team. Participation is free and prizes will be awarded. Registration closes on Friday, April 12th. For a complete list of competition guidelines and rules, visit the city's website. Coming up after the break is our Way to Go GSO shout out. Stay with us. As we draw to a close, we always want to end on a positive note with our Way to Go GSO shout out. This week's shout out goes to the city of Greensboro. The Water Resources Department is hosting a poster contest open to students attending public and private schools as well as homeschools in Guilford County. The theme, Be a Water Wizard, aims to teach students in grades K through 8 about the vital role of water and the importance of conserving it. A complete list of contest rules and guidelines can be found on the city's website, and the contest deadline is 11:59 p.m. on Friday, April 12th. Posters will be judged, and the winners will be announced in early spring and will go on to represent Greensboro in a statewide event. To enter the poster contest, please visit the city's website. That concludes this edition of FYI Weekly, but you can easily stay connected to the latest city news by linking to us on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. Alexa users can subscribe to our 5-minute flash briefings, which airs on 90.1 FM, 100.7 FM, and 90.5 FM. Be sure to download both weekly podcasts, Talk City Greensboro and Connect GSO, plus GTN is streaming on Roku. For all of us here at the City of Greensboro, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.